I'd like to open the course. First of all, congratulate everyone for coming and attending here. And I'm sure that we're going to have a very interesting course. And I would like to thank all the speakers for agreeing to come and speak here. And I would like to also congratulate everyone on behalf of Professor Moshe Drei, Chairman of the Department of Radiology of Tel Aviv Medical Center, who was unable to attend because of health problems. But he is sending his best wishes to everybody. Before we start, I would like to also point out that in a month or so, there is going to be an ESGA LIVO workshop in Tel Aviv. We have a lot of registrants already, Israeli registrants, and anyone that is not yet registered is encouraged to do so. I think it's going to be a very interesting workshop. I would like to now call Kobi Sosna, the chairman of the Israeli Neurological Society.
Thank you, Professor Rasham. I'm very happy to open the sixth French Israeli review course in radiology here in Tel Aviv. It's started in 2008, so it's not a new course, and a lot of the speakers and a lot of the people that come here have been here many times. And it's a special privilege to thank Dr. Beleish for organizing the course, and Dr. Hiller and Dr. Amitai for being the Israeli counterpart that organized the course. I think it's very important to have this course, and it's not only the scientific part, but also in having residents, young residents from both sides, from the Israeli side and the French side, coming here. And this is the seeds that we expected would be connected in having the personal, the scientific, and the international collaboration that I think that is going to happen. This week we are going to have three celebrations. First of all, the first celebration is this one. It's a celebration of science and radiology for the next 3 days. Tomorrow we are going to have celebration of democracy, which is important. I don't know what each one of us will vote, and that this is not important. The important thing that we are going to have this celebration. And the third one is next Saturday, celebration of nature in the Jewish calendar, in the fourth month of Shvat, the middle of the month, we have the holiday of the trees, the holiday of the plants, in which we go out and plant trees for the future. And I believe that what we have here of having young residents, and we put the seeds in getting them the knowledge and getting them to connect with our part, is part of planting trees or planting seeds for the future. So we have three celebrations. We have beautiful weather for the next coming days. So enjoy the conference, enjoy Israel, and enjoy nature in the weekend. So enjoy.
So it's the year of the Olympics in Israel, I guess it's the best in the summer, so thank you so much for the talk. So I don't know what to do and what to say after what you said, it's just perfect. So I just want to thank you all for being here and welcoming us all the time, and it's really wonderful for us to be here. So I want to call Dr. Leo Koppel for the first talk, thank you.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank the committee for asking me to give this presentation. I hope you enjoyed. So my talk is about BAD/DAG imaging, spectrum of pathologies. When we look at BAD/DAG imaging, we have to look at pathologies with some modalities. We have the ultrasound, which is very good for screening and also for characterization lesions. If you have an intraorbital lesion, you can see if there is any flow inside it, yes or no, if it has shadow. Secondly, I think the second most important one is MRI, when you can characterize lesion and also staging. CT is very good for characterization and staging. However, the contrast resolution of CT for bile ducts is less than with MRI. And finally, we have the RCP and DTC, which we reserve it more and more for treatment and not for diagnosis. So I prepared a bunch of cases, and let's start from the more easy one to the more complicated one. So first one, it's a 57-year-old male with abdominal pain, elevated liver function test, and this patient is post-polycystitis and post-polycystectomy. So this is an ultrasound which was performed, and as you can see here, there is no intrahepatic bile ducts. The choledochus, or the extrahepatic bile ducts, it's a little bit enlarged. However, we cannot see the end of this duct, and we cannot see if there is any pathology here. So he commits with abdominal pain, and this is the MRCP which was performed. These are T2 images with fat saturation, and as you can see here, there is an intrahepatic bile duct dilatation. And going down, this is the choledochus, and in the choledochus you can see around a filling defect, which is lying on gravity down. And here the mid reconstruction, this is for demonstration. However, we can see very nice this filling defect here, here, and here. This is the pancreatic duct. These are dilated extrahepatic bile ducts and intrahepatic bile ducts, more on the left than on the right. And this is the filling defect. So, the differential diagnosis, and I want all the residents to think about this because question is coming. Is it a common bile duct stone? Is it a tumor? Is it air or polyp? And the question is, of course, it's a stone. What we know about choledocholithiasis? Calculi in the distal common bile duct will give symptoms in 90% of the patients. About common bile duct stones, in 50 to 25% of patients with acute calculus polycystitis, you can find stones in the bile ducts, extrahepatic bile ducts. However, there is 10 to 15% of patients with polycystitis with unsuspected common bile duct stones in surgery. So this is a little more problem that we think about. What about MRCP and diagnosis of choledocholithiasis? I talked about HASTE or single shot fast spin echo, which is an older technique. And even with this technique, you can see stones more than 2 millimeters in diameter. And we can even do better with T2 turbo fast spin echo. The sensitivity is for 80 to 100% specificity is very high. And look at this data. There may be stones in normal diameter common bile duct in 12% of the patients. And another thing which is very important, common bile duct abnormalities with MRCP. If you say it's negative, the bile ducts are normal in 95% of the patients. And if you say there is a pathology, you are right in 97% of the cases. So this is very, very important, the negative and positive predicted value. Let's see this case. This is a patient with abdominal pain, post-polycystectomy. She's 76-year-old. She has abdominal pain, and she is post-polycystectomy and ERCP. And this is images, axial T2 images with fat saturation. This is the bile duct, and here you see a filling defect. This time the filling defect is not lying down, it's up. So there is a fluid filling defect level, as you see here and here. And this is the coronal HASTE without fat set, and this is a longitudinal filling defect. So in this case, it's the same differential diagnosis. Is it a stone? Is it a tumor? Is it air? Or is it structure? And the answer is, of course it's air, because air is going up, it's very light, It's not a pending down, so this is not a stone and this is a nail. And this is a very important pitfall when you look at this examination, not to say it's a stone. Next case, dilatation of the bile ducts. This is a 76-year-old female with recurrent cholangitis, chronic cholecystitis, elevated liver function test, and bile duct dilatation. And this is the MRCP images. As you can see here, this is a coronal view without fat saturation. This is a diverticle of the second part of the duodenum with air, so it's hypo-intense. Here are the bile ducts, the extrahepatic bile ducts. And as you can see here, there's a filling defect. However, it's a more coming from outside and depressing a mass effect on the bile ducts. And this is on the mid reconstruction. Once again, coming from outside, and here you see the bile ducts. These are the axial images with fat saturation, T2. So you see there is an intrahepatic bile duct dilatation. Coming down, this is the common hepatic duct. And as you see here, there is a lesion, hypo-intense lesion, compressing from outside the bile ducts, as you see here. And going down, this is the choledocus with no filling defect. And this is the component, a T1 image with fat saturation. And as you can see, there is a lesion which is hypo-intense, compressing the bile ducts. These are MIP reconstructions. This is the intrahepatic right and left bile ducts. This is the extrahepatic bile ducts, and this is the filling defect, compressing the bile ducts here. And my question to you, is it a common bile duct stone? Is it a tumor? Is it a Meritzi syndrome or common bile duct stricture? And the question, it's a Meritzi syndrome. So Meritzi syndrome, what we mean? It's a gallstone impacted, usually in the cystic in the gallbladder neck. It has a compression on common hepatic duct or common bile duct. Usually the patient has obstruction and jaundice, and the mass effect may be from a stone or from chronic inflammation of the gallbladder. We can see it in 0.1% of patients with gallstones. Complication is, of course, a fistula, choledochocystal fistula, or a fistula to the duodenum. And this is very, very important when planning cholecystectomy because bile duct injury may occur. Third case, abdominal pain and vomiting. This is an 85-year-old female, new onset abdominal pain, vomiting, and no previous abdominal surgery. And this is the plain film. You can see some air in the plain abdominal film, in the stomach, and some small bowel loops of vulvar conventus, which are dilated. Here is the cecum, and as you can see, there is no dilatation of the colon. But when you look very, very well, there are some air bubbles, and I hope you can see it here in the right upper quadrant. And my question to you, looking only at this film, of course this is a small bowel obstruction. Is it a fibrinogen? Is it a gallstone illus? Is it internal hernia? Or is it a colon carcinoma obstructing the small bowel? Let's go on and see what we see here. This is a CT of this patient. This is the stomach filled with contrast material, and here we can see a tract going here laterally from the second part of the duodenum. This is the gallbladder, which is shrinked with some contrast material within it, some fluid around it, and fat swelling. And there are some air bubbles, which we saw them very nice on the plain abdominal field. Going down, this is a small bowel obstruction. The colonic loops are not distended, of course. They are collapsed. Going down, small bowel obstruction with air fluid levels. And going down is a round filling defect in the terminal loop. These are reconstructions, coronal reconstruction, gallbladder which is ring with some air bubbles, dilated bowel loops, and oval filling defect in the distal terminal ileum. So we come back to the differential diagnosis, fibrinogen, gallstone ileus, internal hernia, or colon carcinoma. And of course, the right answer is gallstone ileus. So this is a frequent cause of mechanical bowel obstruction. Usually it's an impacted stone when there's a change in the diameter of the bolus, or usually it's mainly in the terminal ileum. There's a biliary enteric fistula, often to the duodenum. In elderly women, more frequent than men, and there is abrupt onset of abdominal pain and vomiting. There is a triad, with a calcified stone may be seen in ectopic location, gas in shrunk gallbladder or gas in the biliary tree, and mechanical small bowel obstruction. Next case, this is a 34-year-old male with abdominal pain and weakness, and this patient is known to have ulcerative colitis. You will see coronal thin slices to a T2 sequence with a fat saturation. So we drop the signal of everything and we see only signal of one fluid which has a very long TR. So we see here the intrahepatic bile ducts in the right, so there is some bleeding here. There is a dilatation of the main right hepatic duct. There is also some change in the diameter of left bile duct. And going here, there's also a change in the choledochus and some bleeding on the left. This is a mid-reconstruction of this patient. So there's the stenosis part here on the left main duct. This is a dilatation. There is some bleeding on the right, as you see it here, and see it here very, very nice. So my question to you, is it an intrahepatic bile duct fibrosis? It's a recurrent pyogenic cholangitis? Is it a primary biliary cirrhosis? Or is it a primary sclerosing cholangitis? And the question is, of course, this is a primary sclerosing cholangitis. This is a chronic cholestatic disease, autoimmune most probably. There are changes in the intra-extrahepatic bile ducts. There is a patchy inflammation, fibrosis, and structuring. There is a progressive obliteration of the bile ducts. Complication may be biliary cirrhosis, hepatic failure, and cholangiocarcinoma. The median age of the patients is 39 years old. Male to female is 1.5 to 2 to 1. This is a great association with inflammatory bowel disease, especially of ulcerative colitis in up to 80% of the patients. The median survival is 12 years, and the only definitive treatment is liver transplantation. Up to 44% of the patients are asymptomatic, but symptoms when they occur, we can see right upper quadrant pain, fatigue, jaundice, recurrent cholangitis, and signs of liver failure. Next case, multiple liver lesions. This is an 86-year-old female. She came for evaluation of multiple liver lesions, elevated LFT, and there was a question, of course, of metastatic disease. This is the CT. We have a multi-imaging of the liver, multiphasic, and I'm bringing you only the venous phase. And as you can see, there are multiple tiny lesions inside the liver, no more than 15 millimeters. The biggest lesion measures fluid density, and the smaller lesions are too small to be characterized. This is a coronal view of the same patient, so you see multiple small lesions. And this is the MRO which was done to evaluate these lesions. So you see with HES, there are a lot of tiny lesions, white bulb appearance, which is consistent with fluid like the gallbladder. This is the T2 with fat saturation, multiple small tiny lesions, less than 15 millimeters in diameter. And this is a mid reconstruction, which is very, we can appreciate very much. So you see the widespread of innumerable tiny lesions which contain fluid. This is the post contrast evaluation, and you see no lesion has enhancement. So, however, there are some lesions with a rim of enhancement. And this is the coronal views. So my question to you, is it a Mucin containing metastasis? Is it the biliary hamartomas, a von Meyenberg complex? Is it a liver simple cyst or choroid disease? And the question is, of course, this is a biliary hamartomas, which is a von Meyenberg complex. What we see in the state, the light is that like structures lined by biliary epithelium and fibrotic stroma. There are multiple tiny lesions, less than 15 millimeters, spread all throughout the liver. On CT, they look low density. On MMR, we can see high T2, low T1. And when we press the echo time on T2, it's like water. So the T2 signal is also increased. There is no enhancement, however, ring enhancement is in these lesions. And last but not least, this is an 80-year-old female with obstructive jaundice, elevated CA99. This is the CT which was performed. This is a multiphasic CT. We see only the venous phase. And as you can see, there is dilatation of the intrahepatic bile ducts. The common hepatic duct is dilated here. And coming down, the lactate of the choledochus, and here there's a three-point vision inside the distal bile duct. See it here. This is the reconstruction. We see it very nice. The dilated extrahepatic bile ducts with a polypoid lesion near the ampulla and intrahepatic bile ducts dilatation. And this is the MR which was performed. And the MR was performed after insertion of a stent. So the stent is seen here. And the proximal intrahepatic bile ducts are dilated. And the extrahepatic bile ducts are dilated, the proximal one. And going down here, we see only the stent lumen with some bile. However, we do not see the choledochus here. And this is, of course, the pancreatic duct. Here, there are high-resolution images of the liver, T2 with fat saturation, so dilated intrahepatic bile ducts. Please pay attention to new lymph nodes near the gastrohepatic ligament. Here, we see dilatation of the common hepatic duct. And coming down, this is the stent, and this is a hypointense lesion encircling the stent, as you can see here. This is the reconstruction of this case, so you can see the dilatation of the bile ducts intrahepatic, and this is the stent. This is the pancreatic duct with some side branches which are dilated, and here you can see the stent and dilatation of the intrahepatic bile ducts. This is a post-contrast examination with fat saturation. And you see some enhancement of the bile ducts wall. And coming down here, this is the stent, this is the lumen of the stent, and there is some soft tissue which enhance around it. So my question to you, is it a cholangiocarcinoma? Is it a benign common bile duct structure? Is it a common bile duct stone or primary sclerosing cholangitis? And the question, the right answer is cholangiocarcinoma, and this was proved by cytology. So cholangiocarcinoma is the second most common primary hepatobiliary tumor after hepatocellular carcinoma. We can see it most prevalent in the seventh decade, more in men than in women. There are four types. One is the mass-forming type, which is the exophytic one, and there is a like space-occupying lesion inside the liver. The second type is a periductal one, which we call it infiltrative because it infiltrates the liver around the bile ducts. The third one is intraductal, which is a polypoid form, something like it started here. And the fourth one is a mixed type, which is a mass-forming and periductal type. Risk factors are numerous. However, we should look at primary sclerosing cholangitis, choledochal cyst, polyposis, hepatolithiasis, and congenital hepatic fibrosis. There is a very important rule to inject contrast material and with this type of tumor to do the lead enhancement because there is a desmoplastic composition of the tumor. And these are the types which are intrahepatic and extrahepatic form, as I told you. And one of the types can do space-occupied lesion inside the liver with no connection to the bile ducts. So in this session, we talked about bile pathologies. We started with a simple one with the stones and go to some inflammatory changes and after that to tumoral changes. I want to thank everyone for listening and hope you enjoy. Thank you very much.
you very much, Dr. Koppel. So Marie-Pierre William will come now for a talk about solitary cyst of the pancreas. Thank you for coming here again, Marie.
Solitary cysts. You will see it's easy to diagnose of them. So, first of all, to assess that a cyst is solitary in the pancreas, you must perform MRI. And in this paper concerning IPMN, the rate of MRI is much better than MDCT. You can see here this little cyst with MDCT, and with MRI, there are four. In the same patient, a little cyst here, and with MRI, there are many. So you must perform 2D MRCP or 3D MRCP. With 2D MRCP, here in this case, there are thick slices with coronal and radiated slices. 9 slices are necessary and sufficient to explore the whole main pancreatic duct and duct of the pancreas. So, the most important fact is to see how is the external shape of the cyst. Is it round or lobulated? And because there's a point with I will invite you to read this paper. And I yes. So Kim Adjer 206, read this paper. And this shape, the thickness of the wall will give you the answer. If the wall is thin, it will be a simple cyst or macrocystic serous cystadenoma. If the wall is thick or enhanced, you will be in front of pseudocyst or mucinous cystadenoma or neuroendocrine tumor. If there is a nodule in the cyst, it is malignant mucinous cystadenoma or pseudopapillary unsolid cyst. Let's move on this. Okay. So, the cyst is seen without enhancement. The cyst is small, less than 1 centimeter, and then you are in front of a simple cyst. Surgery is not necessary, and follow probably not necessary. A simple cyst is round or oval without septa, with a sharp wall, thin wall without enhancement, and homogeneous. Here is a simple cyst, here without any enhancement. And if you read this paper concerning MRI, 20% of patients have cysts, and many of them are small cysts, and these cysts are more frequent with old people than this, and these cysts are most often a serous simple cyst at pathology. So simple cyst, no surgery. Then if the cyst is bigger, you can be in front of a serous macrocystic unilocular cystadenoma. It's an infrequent lesion.